Hello, everybody. Welcome to DeMars Coaching. My name is David DeMars. I'm a certified life coach. I'm assisting people recovering from narcissistic abuse. This is a question and answer video that I do every single Monday, and I'm answering your guys' questions from last Monday. And anytime, any questions you guys have, please go down below into the comment section. Ask me anything you want. I'll answer them next Monday in the next question and answer video. I want to welcome new subscribers. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for subscribing to the channel. Channel's growing really well, and you guys, if you like what I'm doing and you want to support me in any way, all you have to do is hit the subscribe button. Thank you. So, first thing I'd like to do is thank Willa for donating to the channel. Willa has been a great contributor to the channel for some time now. Thank you very much, Willa. I appreciate your support and your gestures. Just really help me, encourage me, and keep me going. Thank you very much, Willa. I would like to also bring something up that I talk about every once in a while. It's something that I support, and it's called Shane's Law Petition. Shane was a victim of a very ongoing narcissistic smear campaign where he was targeted by a narcissist in public. It went on and on and on for so long. Shane couldn't find any help anywhere, nowhere to turn, and Shane took his own life. And someone started a petition to start a law to stop this public targeting of people. So if you guys could, and it doesn't matter who you are, follow the link down below in the description box that says Shane's Law Petition. It'll take you to the website where you can just support it by signing your name, or just, I don't remember, it's like a little robotic catcha box you can check. So that would be great support for something like this. Even if you're not in America, let this start in America and then get to your country, okay? Something I also like to do every week is give a recommendation. It could be all kinds of things from a person I'm supporting or with their message or books that they write, stuff like this, or things that can help you, maybe your body heal from things. And that's what I'm going to suggest this week. It's something called sumac, and it's something that I had a feeling it had some healing properties some time ago. But it's something that I like to put on my food, and it's something that I found when I realized how much I like Mediterranean cuisine. I think it's the best in the world, and that's Arabic, Persian, all around the Mediterranean, and they use an ingredient. It's kind of like Arabic allspice, and it's an ingredient they put on their food, and I love it. I put tons of it on my food, and it tastes really good, but it also has some healing properties. And I like to recommend stuff that's just natural too, so we aren't all on drugs, and I don't like to really recommend drugs. I can't really do that. So sumac, I found an article, says natural healing snack on sumac berries. And it says one man's pest is another man's pearl. Dandelion root and flowers may be considered pesky weeds. Nettles may seem like the most unlikely side dish. The sumac bush may look like just another roadside shrub. To the resourceful, all these plants are both food and medicine. Cooks from many countries, including Turkey, Italy, and Israel, have revered sumac berries for more than 1,000 years, and yet the fruits are hardly something to make a meal or snack of. They are smaller than gooseberries, contain almost as much pit as fruit, and have very little fragrance. They aren't even sweet. What sumac berries do have going for them is a brilliant brick to purple, burgundy color, a tart and tangy taste, and a bushel full of therapeutic applications. And just a little more here. Sumac leaves and berries are classified as astringent and cooling. Certain Native American and Canadian Indian tribes use sumac to treat bladder, digestive, reproductive, and respiratory ailments, infections, injuries, stomach aches, arrow wounds, and more. The Chippewa Indians of North America made a decoction of sumac flowers to treat gas, indigestion, and other digestive upsets. The Iroquois use sumac as a laxative, diuretic, expectorant, liver aid, and in countless other applications. The powdered bark and dried berries were allegedly combined with tobacco and smoked during peace pipe ceremonies. Blah, blah, blah. Tons of other treatments. Hemorrhoids. Using as cough syrup, induced vomiting. All kinds of uses, medicinal uses for it. And I just, like I said, I love using it. It's something that would be on a table of an Arabic or Persian restaurant. So it's something that tastes good, something that's good for you. Something that I've noticed, doctors know, that something that happens to people during emotional abuse, one major thing is stomach problems, digestive problems. A lot of people have irritable bowel syndrome after years of emotional abuse. So this is something that helps a lot of this stuff, helps your digestive system. So I thought it'd be a nice recommendation, something you can start adding to your food, especially if you like how it tastes. But you don't have to eat it. You can take it in different forms. And I will put a link down below in the description box to my favorite Amazon, and so that you guys can get some of that if you like. It's pretty affordable. So let's see if I'm forgetting anything else. All I ask you guys, please, is leave me your location. If you ask me a question, please tell us where you're from. And also be nice if you subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Thank you. So, trying to think if I forgot anything. I think that's it. Let's start with the first question from Monisha. And don't know where you're from, Monisha. Hi, does a narcissist face karma? Do they get back for the stuff they have done to others? I hope you can make a separate video on this topic. And I've talked about this many, many times in other videos. I think one of the best ones is like revenge, stuff like this. I made a video just titled Revenge that talks about this. And, you know, I mean, all I can tell you is like my opinion on karma. And that's, try to realize that I don't think there's some magical force, you know, that hurts you if you hurt people. Try to realize that the universe doesn't care about right or wrong, good or bad. Doesn't exist. Everything that happens is necessary. But human beings living together in society with others, society works a certain way, and you either work with it or you're working against it. Hurting people, abusing people is working against this system. Okay, so you don't get to reap benefits from the system either. And it's really hard to see this from a victim standpoint. And I hope that after you guys, now that you're not being victimized anymore and you start healing over time, you're able to see that you can't live your life the way that they live their life. I understand they do, and I understand after they hurt you so bad and they move on with someone else and they're on Facebook putting pictures on there that they look like they're happy and stuff like this. No, they're not, okay? No, they're not. We can't judge people by Facebook pictures and stuff like this. They're just what people, you know, smiling and telling you I'm happy, or what did they tell other people? There is much to life to learn, and a lot. And there's a lot of experiences out there. There's a lot of good and great things about life and people and having relationships with people. Tons and tons of benefits that they will not ever experience as long as they keep hating themselves and hating and hurting other people. You just can't. They won't. There's a lot of stuff in life that they will miss out on. So if you live your life a certain way, and that's hurting people, stuff like this, you can't know who you are. You don't have a certain set of principles in your life that are solid. You don't know how to give yourself things that you need, so they don't get things they need. They don't feel better because they don't feel good. They hate themselves and they don't fix these things. They go on from relationship to relationship to relationship, giving a part of themselves away in each relationship, where the person gets to know them a little bit, and then they leave that relationship and it's always bad. It's always negative. They've always hurt somebody. That person always hates them. Things like this. So they have to go on life, on and on and on life, with nothing solid, nothing that supports who they are, or it's just bad, it's negative. They don't get to choose who to be with. They can only be with unhealthy people. They can only be with people with low self-worth, low self-esteem. They can only be with people who have been neglected in childhood or abused or abandoned, stuff like this, okay? They have difficulties relating to people, period. They don't connect with people. They feel lost, scared, confused, depressed, anxious, okay? They don't know how to self-soothe and take care of themselves. They don't know how to make themselves feel better. The times that you guys have been able to pick yourself up off the floor at your worst times and tell yourself you're okay. They can't do that. They're completely dependent on people more than you'll ever be. There's just so much more to living like this that doesn't ever turn out good for them. And they don't know how to fix it or change it. They just keep lying to themselves. They're delusional. They're out of touch with reality. They lack awareness. They can't self-examine. They can't be vulnerable. They can't tell people what they want, how they feel. They can't even apologize sincerely. They can't commit. They can't, I mean, there's, they can't, you know, they have problems really attaching to anybody. They can't, it's just so much. And I'm telling you guys, the most important things in our lives are relationships with other people. Okay, if we could live in total isolation away from society, there'd be a ton more people doing it, but they can't. They can't. People that go live out in the wild by themselves die without any human contact at all. There aren't people living out there by themselves doing nothing. There might be a few couple sociopaths or something, you know, Ted Kaczynski or something, but he still had contacts with human. I mean, you can't do it. We need society. And if you don't work with it and you work against it, it will not work for you. Okay? Okay. So let's move on. I hope that helps, Manisha. We don't need to... It's like when people want to take revenge on a narcissist, it's like beating up a three-legged dog. It's like kicking a horse when it's down. You know, and it's just you guys, how you've been treated and how you feel, that you guys think they're up here and you think they're doing great and feeling great and happy. They fooled you. Okay, you're believing the look on their face or what they're telling you. But deep down inside, they absolutely hate themselves. How do I know? Because they treated you badly. Anybody that treats people badly feels badly. I've hurt people. You know, in relationships, I said something bad before and I realized I hurt them. And I know that I wasn't happy and I wasn't feeling good about myself. And now that I am, I don't hurt people. I treat people better and stuff, right? So think about it. You guys, you know, you talked about you've hurt your ex. You hurt them back, okay? Well, how did you feel? Why did you hurt them back, right? You weren't happy. You were hurting. Stuff like this. So try to realize why they're doing the things they are, how it shows you a little bit how they feel, okay? And you can't go through life feeling like that. And if they think that the answer is just a new relationship, a new person, they're totally lost and confused. Okay, next question is from Carol in Calgary, Canada. Hello, Carol. I'm here speaking from Calgary, Canada. Help. Next question from Carol. Okay, help. Parental alienation. The narc has new supply, 2.5 years, and he tells the kids it's his new girlfriend's stepmother. I'm petrified as I'm their mother. What do I do? You don't need to do anything, Carol. I don't know what you can do. So your kids have contact with their father, and they have to. They want to. They're going to. He wants to tell the kids that this is their new stepmother. Best thing to do is not get involved. Best thing to do is try to tell your children not to tell you about it too much. Best thing to do is not focus on it, not think about it. Focus on where you want to be in life. Okay? And start working towards that. And stop looking. Try to stop listening. Try to stop caring. Okay, Carol, get support, talk to people, okay? If this was your husband, and I guess you were married to him for some time, and you had plans for the rest of your life with him, and now he is gone, that's a big void in your life, and I hope you have replaced that void with something, Carol, okay? And if you haven't, that might be why it's affecting you so much after 2.5 years. Okay, Carol, we need to start healing about this relationship and start learning what's going on and realizing you're not a bad person, that he was just treating you badly, and try to understand why he was treating you badly. Okay, try to learn more about him and his life and his That's my best advice. You asked here another question from Carol. How do I help my kids, my daughter, 17, and my son, 13? You're not being explicit on how to help them or what their problem is. Sounds like maybe they went through divorce 2.5 years ago. That's something that can be painfully damaging to children at that age. So I hope that you have been able to help them process this experience, this traumatic experience for them, and haven't just, you know, been involved with this husband and fighting with him. And, you know, I hope you're taking care of yourself. So how do I help the children? Well, be the best mother you can be. So be the strongest, healthiest, most happiest mom you can be. Okay? Period. And that means you come first. You take care of you, and then you can take care of your children. Okay, the sooner you take care of you, the sooner you can take care of your children. You take care of yourself right now, and then next you can take care of your children, okay? So if you need help, then go get help, right? If this is too hard, if this is something that you see as damaging, something that you can't handle on your own, then we go get assistance. The best help is the one that we hire, the ones that we pay for, the ones that work for us. The ones that have experience and knowledge, been through this before and helped other people recover from this, help them before, okay? So, how do you help your kids? Real general question, give them the help they need. If you don't know what that is, go learn what it is or go hire it, okay? You know, be involved in their school. Maybe tell their counselor at school what's going on. Be talking to people at school so you know if there are problems. If you know if there's something wrong at school, they may not want to come home and tell you or show you what that is. You may not be aware of what's going on. We want their grades to be okay. We want them to attend. We don't want them hanging out with bad kids. We need to know these things, okay? And the school may need to know what they're going through. It might help them. We need to help get them into some type of counseling therapy. We need to help them understand what's going on. We need to help them understand what's going on with you and what's going on with Dad, how to deal with Dad. If Dad has a personality disorder and Dad abuses people, these children need to know how to deal with that, because you're not going to be able to keep them away from him. Most likely. Most states don't do that. They don't care what your opinion is, and they don't care about a personality disorder. They care about abuse, but you're going to need proof, and it's just a real hard thing to do. So most likely, they're going to be able to be in contact with your children, so teach them how. Okay, Carol, teach them how. Be strong for them, so don't have them comfort you. Mom needs to be strong. Mom's problems are mom's problems, and mom's problems are handled by mom, and they're all being handled. We're okay. We need to focus on you, on the two children. How are you feeling? What are you doing? What are you thinking? How are you taking this divorce? How is school? How are your friends? How is dating? How are your teachers? Okay? Focus on them. And then your recovery and the things that you need are separate. They don't need to know about this. Mom's okay. They need to be concentrating on themselves, not you. And that's real common that happens. So please, good luck, okay? Just get help. If you need help, get help. Period, guys. You guys need help, can't do something by yourself, get help. David from Ontario, Canada. You ask, so this is from Ontario, Canada. Okay, thanks, David. I'm learning of me for me. One thing that I may break the mold, but as part of being done with her, I shut her off and out 100%. Her games. She tried to break me, but all was ignored. Divorcing one sick. Narc. Was unreal crazy. Not one legally wanted to take on for less than $1,500 an hour. Not to mention the narc loving judge. Questions today is, after watching lots of narc videos, after 25 year marriage, I understand the traits, yet I just can't see her as the calculating narc. Why? She did harm this family and did the heinous child abuse to extreme, but I try to see the remain blind and anything planned except harm, destroy, brainwashing kids. This is kind of hard to understand. I just can't see her as the calculating narc. Why? Okay, so that's a good question. So if I got this right, David's asking, after watching all these narcissist videos in this community and everyone's narcissist videos, after 25-year marriage, I understand the traits, yet I just can't see her as the calculating narc. She did harm this family and did the heinous child abuse to extreme, but I try to see and remain blind to anything planned except harm, destroy, brainwashing kids. Great question. The reason I like this question so much is because this is a product of traumatic abuse. We can think the abuser is much bigger than they are. We hear that they're narcissists, we find out that they're narcissists, and then we get this information that they're such nasty, corrupt, plotting, planning people, and they've been planning your whole demise, your whole relationship, right? Not true. Not true. People making videos on narcissists are also victims, and they're at different places. They're at different areas of their recovery. And you'll notice, I mean, put it this way. Emotional maturity means you understand people, period. Means you're pretty good at understanding people. So you don't think they're big, bad aliens, devils, Jezebel spirit, nobody. Okay, you're not saying that about people, period. Not narcissists, not anybody, okay? Because then you start understanding them, and then they're not monsters. There aren't monsters walking around on the planet. But I know our reaction to this type of abuse is, oh my God, yes, they're monsters, they need to die, put them on an island, they're not real human beings. I've heard it all, trust me. And it's just, it's garbage. It's garbage. It gives you no understanding at all. To make videos and tell everyone that they've been plotting and planning, like you know what every narcissist has been doing, and not just going by your own experience, is crazy. I mean, come on. So be careful what information you're watching and listening to. If you're watching and listening to just a person who's just been a victim of this, and they're telling you their experience, realize that everyone reacts differently. Everyone has a different experience, not the same as yours. And not everyone has the same brain as yours, or thinking the same way as you, or as healthy as you, or not, you know. It's all so different. So you can listen to people's experiences. That's great. Listen to more. Listen to a lot then. Listen to people who have moved on, who have healed from this for years, instead of this happened last year, 6 months ago, you know. And I hate them, they need to die, and we need to revenge them, and stuff like this, okay? Try to listen to people who really make sense, who tell you things that really benefit you. Typically things that feel better, okay? Most narcissists and borderlines, stuff like this, abusers, they're so highly impulsive. That's why they do the things they do. Not because they've been plotting and planning for years and years. Trust me, dude. Trust me. I've learned this over many years, helping many, many people. Okay, it's a sign of emotional maturity. I've been maturing. And I don't think narcissists are, you know, not human anymore. I did years ago when I found this stuff out and I was still healing and yeah. Okay, so that's a good question, David. I doubt your ex plotted and planned all this. I would imagine your ex is highly impulsive, emotionally unstable. If they have a personality disorder, then they do. They are impulsive, and they aren't in very control of their behaviors. That is a clear depiction of, what makes up a personality disorder. One part of that is saying, I'm not in very good control of my behaviors. I'm highly impulsive and act out impulsive thoughts. So I hate you today, and 5 minutes later, I love you again, and I feel stupid, so I act like nothing happened. And I say, it was your fault. You made me do that, you know? You see, that's not planning. I've seen impulsive people. I saw an impulsive person file for divorce, leave their job, leave the country, move to another country, meet someone, get married and have children within a year or two, and just completely crumbled and said, why did I do all this? I never wanted to leave my wife and children. I can't believe I did this. Just totally impulse. It's okay. It makes, and it could look like that person planned it all out. Try to have understanding. That's why I tell you guys, healing is understanding. It does no good to point the finger. It does no good to avenge or revenge someone and hurt them. It does no good to label people as aliens, devils, spirits, lizards, meat suits. I've heard it all. We're human beings and we're all equal. And if you guys will not see people that way, period. If there are people you don't see equal, I'm telling you this, okay? From experience, if you don't see human beings, all of us, as equal, then that leaves the door open for you to be less than equal, okay? I hope that makes sense. And if you suffer from self-esteem, low self-esteem, worth, things like this, and you compare yourselves to people and you think that some of us are more or better than worse than others, that just makes your self-esteem drop. Okay? Unless you're lying to yourself all day and telling yourself that you're better than everyone else all the time. Okay? And that doesn't work either. Narcissist, that doesn't work. You can't just tell yourself you're better than everybody else. We are equal, and that will help your self-esteem. That will help anxiety. You walk into a room, you're worried about what people say or think you're gonna do, you realize if you truly feel it and know that we're all equal, you will feel better in social situations. You realize that maturity is important and matters to people, that we aren't little children anymore, and we don't make fun of people anymore, and the ones that do are immature, and who cares? It'll help anxiety, okay? We are equal. And I think narcissists, you know, I think of people horizontally, right? We're all equal. I think narcissists think of people vertically. And one day they're better than people, and the next day they're worse than people. And that's what creates low self-esteem, okay? So important to remember that. I'm gonna try and fit one more in here. Christy Jones from Union, Washington. Hello. My mother-in-law is a narcissist. I'm just realizing after 6 years, all the effects everything my husband went through and continues to go through with his mom has had on him. As bad as his life was and as hard as it is to know her now, he sticks up for her no matter what she does or says or does. He lets her treat him like a servant because she will buy him things. I guess my question is, for sons of narcissistic mothers, is this common? He gets away with anything. She comes down on me very hard about my book, my looks, parenting, etc. She has always expected him to come when called to control his younger brother, whom has autism. I'm starting to feel like they are married and not us. I don't need to read more. Yeah, it's common. Yeah, it's real common. And it's called, it's the mother not supporting his autonomy. His autonomous self. So he can't possibly have a very good self formed. So this man probably doesn't know who he is very well. So you're married to somebody who doesn't know who he is very well. People like that are impulsive. People like that cannot commit. They're not serious. They don't know themselves. Sure, I'll do that. Well, who are you? I don't know. Not very reassuring. Not very secure. I'm sure you feel scared in this relationship a lot. Unsafe. Unsettled. And yeah, it's very common to feel like he's married to his mother. It's gross. It's disgusting. He's our little baby boy. When I think of this, I always think of the mother laying the big 6 foot 200-pound man on his back, and she's got his ankles up, holding the legs up in the air, changing his diaper and clothing him, powdering his butt. What a man. Time to grow up, buddy. Get away from your mother. Get away from your sick mother and grow up and be a man instead of just pretending like you're one. Seriously. Because he's being abused by his mom, obviously. So his self-worth and all this is down. You can't have a functional relationship. He doesn't know how to do things for himself. So how can he do anything for you? He can't. You're not in a functional relationship. It can't work like this. Something has to stop or change immediately. Okay? So we draw the line, and you better make that line, and you better let him know what that line is, and you better not cross it. And then there's things he needs to do if he wants to save this marriage, period. And if you don't do these, it's not going to work. Because it's not working now, so what are you going to do about it, right? And it has everything to do with him and not the mother. Mother needs to be out of the relationship. This is him. You hold him accountable for all of this, not her. All of this. He's got a ton of work to do to be in a relationship with anybody. So I don't know what to say about your relationship. But it can be saved. It's up to him. How bad does he want it? And I would make him show you so that you have some security, so you have some hope, so you don't just wait around and be bullshitted, which is what I'm sure he's good at. Good luck. I'm sorry. Marriage counseling, immediately. Couples counseling, immediately. But he needs help. He needs to be in therapy big time. He's got a ton to heal from and a ton to learn. Tons. And then you guys, if you want to make this relationship work, you need to be in therapy as well. The both of you. And you probably should be in therapy as well if you're dating someone like this. If you're married. I think you said you're married. I'm sorry. But, I mean, this is someone who doesn't know himself. This is someone who has extreme low self-esteem and worth. This is the end of part one. I'll see you guys in part two. Thank you very much. If you can, vote up or down, and I'll see you in part two. Thanks.